Ron is 7 years older than I am. I would say the relationship was a very typical little sister, big brother. There was a connection between us, and the connection was that he was a protector. When Ron was only 49 years old, in the fall of 1993, an artery in Ron's brain split open. The bleeding was just tremendous. Ron arrived in intensive care. His pupils were fixed. There was absolutely no response. He was on the lowest level of coma. The chances for immediate survival, in other words, for the next 12 to 24 hours, were less than 5%. This was a severe attack. An artery had broken. It had pushed part of his brain stem down. It was sort of herniating his brain. He was in intensive care. They were pumping his brain out. And he did receive state of the art at that point. But we were warned that it was really, this was a very, very grave situation. Life for me became broken down into surviving 1 second consecutively after the other. And we were told that even if Ron were to survive, he would never emerge from a coma. And it seemed that in those early months after Ron's brain hemorrhage, that I was more than welcome to be at the hospital and to see to his comfort and to bring him flowers. I didn't think at that point that he was going to necessarily come out of it, and I didn't think there would be any form of objection by anybody that he stay like that. And trying to reconcile myself to the fact that probably I would just have a sleeping brother for the rest of my life in his.
Ron.
Of course, the natural thing is you try to stimulate your loved one. You try to wake them up. I mean, even though someone said he'll never wake up, you try here and there to wake them up. But it really wasn't working until one day. Would force Ron's eyelids open, and they stayed open, and he stared at me.
Good, thank you, Ronnie. Yeah, Betsky, tired today?
Hey, Ronnie. Hi.
Hey, good morning. Good afternoon, Ron. Pedro's here.
How come he's never going to wake up?
Yeah.
We were told, but he's waking up.
Yeah.
How come he's opening his eyes? What is this? And we were told that it's not unusual at this point in a coma for a patient to open their eyes.
How are you doing?
That the eye opening in and of itself didn't prove that he had regained consciousness. Was that what was happening, that he was just merely opening his
eyes?
Or was something else happening?
That's good. That's very, very good. You want to look at me a bit? That is cleaning lady.
We noticed when there'd be sound, his eyes would move. Or he'd look for us in the room.
No temperature, right? That must feel good.
Hey, see me over here?
Do you see Ron? Do you see Pedro?
I'm behind the camera. Yeah. Hi, Ronnie.
We've got a camera, and that's in order to trace your progress. It's because sometimes you sleep a lot. That's all.
We bought a video camera to document what it was we were seeing. But was there something else in the medical literature that described someone opening their eyes, being there, but not being able to communicate? And I did find something in the medical literature, and it was a fairly newly described syndrome called the locked-in syndrome. And locked-in is when a person is conscious, able to understand, they're completely paralyzed, they are mute, their eyes are able to move, and you're able to give a series of commands, eye blinks, blink once or blink twice or close your eyes or whatever. The communication is through the eyes because that's the part that's not paralyzed is the eyes. So when I knew that, damn it, I've got something. I've got a syndrome, a medical syndrome that seemingly applies here. So the next step was to see if Ron would be able to follow commands with his eyes.
Okay, this is yes, right, this is no, that's right. What's easier for you? Give me two movements in your eye, two, one, God, boy, oh boy, wow. Close your eyes completely and keep them shut, until I tell you to open them, close them. Peeking. Close them again. Good. Okay, open them now. Now you can open them. Now you can open them. Good. Good.
I felt that there might be some debate as to whether this was really happening. And I think that I wanted to be able to review on my own, in my own living room, what it was that I had seen. I wanted to be dead certain that yes, I said give me two blinks, and yes, he gave me two blinks, because there it is, it's indisputable. I call his attending physician many times, I try to catch him on the floor many times, and finally I catch him and I'm able to talk to him, and I tell him that I think that Ron is locked in. And I tell him that Ron has been following these commands with his eyes.
Try it again, this is
and his response to me is that Ron is not locked in.
And of all, this
they
is
have seen him many, 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 many times. They have examined him many, many, many times. They are the ultimate in optimists. They are the ultimate in examiners and observers. And that Ron is not locked in. So, I mean, I say to him, well, you know, I'm willing to accept whatever it is, but I need an explanation as to what I have on these tapes. At that point, I had collected about, you know, 15 hours of tape. It wasn't all Ron blinking on 15 hours, but I had been shooting for about 15 hours. And so I asked him, well, would you please look at the tape with me and tell me what it is that you're seeing, or look at the tape alone and tell me what it is I'm seeing. And his physician refuses.
That was very good, Ron. That was very good. Not too bad.
When his physician refused to look at the videotape, I immediately became deeply suspicious.
Hey, Ron, look, you're doing it.
I immediately felt that some other agenda was at work here. That there was another level that was not being expressed to me. Because I simply couldn't understand why he wouldn't accept to look at the videotape. And it wasn't until a few months after that, which is now the winter of 1994, that I would come to understand what was going on. January 1994, which is now 4 months post-incident, Ron now can't be aroused to wake up no matter what. He's thinking. And the more violent the winter, and it was a terribly cold, violent winter, became, the worse he became, the deeper he sank. It didn't matter what we did. You could push his eyelids up all you want, you could, whatever it was that you did, he didn't wake up.
Ronnie, come on, open your eyes. It's Bonnie and Pedro. Ronnie, it's Bonnie and Pedro. Come on, Ronnie. Ronnie, wake up. Ron, try opening your eyes up. Ronnie. Ron. Ron.
Maybe he had had another stroke. And that's why. I had no idea what was going on. I did approach my brother's attending physician, and I did ask him what could possibly be happening. Why had we seen this improvement, and now we weren't seeing it anymore? And really, the only response that I got was, you have to understand. I'm repeating myself to you again, and you have to understand that this was a devastating hemorrhage, that you cannot expect anything more. And because he had never admitted that Ron was locked in and that there had been any improvement whatsoever, there was no point discussing it. Well, he had been locked in and there was an improvement and now he's not responding at all. It just fell on deaf ears.
Mark, we gotta shut her down. Miss Mark, that'll crowd. So running boys and tip those guns around. Mark, we gotta shut her down. Miss Mark, that'll crowd.
At that point, I realized that, we needed some outside help. And I sent the scans to the United States. I started making contact in different ways to different physicians, to different neurosurgeons and neurologists in the States. And I started editing these little videos, and I got copies of the CT scans, and I started sending that out. I would tell Ron, hang on. Hang on. By end of that winter, the results of all this sending out of video and all this sending out of CT scans started to come back, and it was unanimous. Ron had developed what is a very common secondary effect with a big brain hemorrhage, and that's hydrocephalus. And basically, it's a very simple thing to understand. This artery that broke now had healed. And in healing, had created a scar. And that scar was interrupting what is the natural flow between the spinal cord and the brain of fluid. And so the fluid was just building in the brain, depressing the rest of the brain, depressing all consciousness. He needed a shunt. He needed basically, a little tube to be inserted into the ventricle. It's a very simple neurosurgical procedure, and he needed that. Ron was very nauseated, had a huge headache, when I say there was no response at all for those months, rarely, once or twice, he came out of it very groggy, gave small indications that he was still there. But he was obviously very, very sick.
Jesus,
Jesus, and you're grabbing my hand. I brought my findings to his attending physician with a discovery of hydrocephalus.
Yeah.
And his physician responded by letter, admitting there was hydrocephalus, admitting it was severe, admitting that he definitely could have a shunt.
How do you feel? Yeah. Okay. Emotionally? Okay.
It admitted that, they are competent to do the surgery, but it named the entire neurological staff agreed that no benefit would accrue. It would be a futile endeavor. No benefit would accrue to Ron. So the answer to us in asking for Ron to have the shunting surgery was no. And it was clear that the motivation was to euthanize him.
If it's emotionally bad, then blink.
I knew that Ron had very serious brain damage, and I knew that maybe the shunt would work, maybe the shunt wouldn't work, but that he would have wanted me. That Ron was so fair-minded that he'd throw a life raft out to somebody, and they weren't going to do the same for him. And they'd put it all under the guise of letting nature take its course. I think that they owed it to him to throw him a life raft and just see what would happen. And so did all the experts to a man agree with me. In realizing that they were not going to cooperate and shunt, we had to get an outside opinion, and we discovered a neurosurgeon in Long Island, New York, and we asked him if he would come and examine Ron. We flew him in the morning from New York and out in the evening. He was our absolute last hope. So he submitted an official report to the hospital. In the paragraph noted as his final impression, he refers to Ron as being apparent locked-in syndrome, now complicated by severe hydrocephalus, and his recommendation was to shunt. Another 3 weeks goes by. No response. Either they don't answer the phone, or they just sort of pretend you're not there and that this isn't on their desk. Finally, I phoned my lawyer, and I said, draw the papers up. We're taking them to court. She said, should we give it one more stab? Should we call their lawyers and tell their lawyers that we're doing this and give 24-hour notice? I said, do so. But in 24 hours, if they don't move, we're going to court. 24 hours elapsed. At the 11th hour, they agreed to shunt.
It sounds worse than it is, Ron, but it's no big deal at all. Okay, what they're going to do is there's a lot of buildup of fluid in your brain.
He managed to crawl to consciousness just prior to the surgery, and I explained what was going to happen, and I knew that I knew he wanted me to go ahead with it.
How do I know? Give me a sign you understand.
Yes.
Me. Did you put your eyebrows up? Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
His name went on the surgical roster, and then they said to me, his name is on the surgical roster, but you have to understand that if an emergency arises, he is low priority and he'll get bumped off the surgical roster. He was dirt. He was dirt. He was a non-person. He was dirt. Complete dirt. But there was no big emergency, and he got the surgery. In his scrubs, the attending physician, in his scrubs, to the door of the operating room, told me it won't make a difference. And I just said, we'll see. We'll see.
So this is Tuesday to Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. This is the third day after the shunt. and Ron is amazing. Ron, put your eyebrows up for the camera. Put your eyebrows right up, real high. Real good. Ron's been having a lot of movement in the right and left hand, in both legs. He moves his head. Move your head. You don't want to? It's the camera, is it? No? Turn your head towards me. Turn your head towards me. Turn your head towards me. That's right, Ron. Very good. Now, can you close your eyes? What? Close your eyes. Now open them. Now blink once. Blink one time. Do a strong blink. Good. Can you do two in a row?
Oh, yeah.
Good. Put your eyebrows up. I don't think we need much more, eh, folks?
No, you guys
are pretty crazy. It's pretty evident what we have here. Let's get some physio.
The first time we've been out of the hospital in almost 8 months.
The first day that we brought Ron out of the hospital and onto the hospital patio, we had discovered a patio right in the middle of this mammoth hospital. There was this little oasis, and it was the month of May, and so the trees were in bud, and Ron had been a person who loved to be outside, and to have been locked up in that room, in that bed, in that hospital, under these very terrible conditions for so many months. It was such a relief to be out there.
Bend back slowly, slowly. Wow.
That's good. Let it hit the back. That's good.
He was alive. He was conscious. He was there. We shared a relationship, even though he couldn't speak. And I loved him. A male nurse on the floor who was very much in our corner, who sort of put it, I think, very succinctly when he said, well, had it been you or me, i.e. a normal person, would anyone have waited 7.5 months to give them a shunt? No, they would have moved very quickly in case there was a chance that this wait would have produced more brain damage. It wasn't as though there were no more obstacles to overcome. There was a constellation of physical disability. And I have to be honest that this was something that haunted me on a daily basis as to whether or not this was making him happy. But he was here, and I had faith that he would get better. I had to have faith that he would get better. And now I was very committed, because I had saved him, I was very committed to carrying this thing through.
Okay. Now try to move your knee. Try to move your knee like that.
So we just took it one small step at a time. He was getting some rehab at the hospital, but it was never enough. And we'd watch what the therapist would do and then repeat it on the patio. In all, I would say that summer we spent 8 hours a day with him, day in and day out, rain or shine, we were always with him, trying to take what little he did show that he had and build on that. Our goal for him was to get him out of the hospital, which was no longer appropriate to him, and into a rehab setting where we hoped they could do more for him. So at the beginning, he could only raise a finger, then slowly the rest of the hands, then the wrist came in.
Good boy. Index finger. Good. Next finger.
They're not going to tell us what to expect in the future. If anything, they're saying at every point, that's as far as he can go. That's as far as he can go. You have to understand it's a very destructive injury.
Open wide, wide, wide. Good.
Try it again. Push down.
Don't drop it now. appreciate yourself, huh? He looks like he's sleeping, doesn't he? Watch this. Make a fist tight, tight. Make a fist tight, tight. Open it up. All your might. I don't think he's asleep.
Sure looks asleep.
But looks can be deceiving, as we know.
We were now obsessed with who the real Ron was. How much of his personality and how much of his intellect had been preserved.
Sky! 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 That's the word that says sky. Point again to the sky. There's the sky. That's the word for sky.
Hey, all of a sudden it's clicked.
That's the word that means ear. If I have one and I add zero, what do I have? One, exactly right. 2 plus 2 equals 1. That's right. A bicycle has how many wheels? That's right. Wait a minute. 2 wheels. That's right. Okay. Close your fingers. We have your answer. Is the sun shining now? Nice bright sun on your face? Yes. Of course. What's this say? 3. Beautiful, Ron.
By the end of that summer, we had made an application. This is the summer of 1994. We had made an application for the September semester of rehab. Ron was refused. But when they refused him, they didn't close the door. They just said, he's not ready, and you'll have to reapply.
Stiffen. I'm gonna let go now. Hold your head there.
He simply did not have the endurance necessary to participate the 3 hours per day that they required.
Hold it. No, you're letting it go. Hold. Stiffen. Stiffen right there. No, you're falling.
So we knew that we were stuck in the hospital, waiting for rehab, waiting for him to be ready for at least another 6 months or so. Months has now gone by since Ron had his initial incident, since he was first admitted. The hospital, in the meantime, is becoming very anxious to clear Ron's bed. So they started to write what is the first step in institutionalizing someone, and that's a report that gives a profile of the patient. And the report claimed that Ron was in a vegetative state. He was in a coma. A semi-coma, some form of semi-coma, and it stated that there was absolutely no hope for improvement whatsoever.
Okay, are you ready to start?
Okay. Ron, give me an A. Ron, give me a B. Ron, give me a C.
Ron had been a radio operator. He loved the code.
Give me an S, please.
And he was an exceedingly competent Morse code operator.
U.
So it occurred to us to bring his key in, his Morse code key in.
Give me a double.
And to see where that could lead us.
X. Y. Okay, Ron, give me a Y again, please. Okay, give me a Z.
Yes!
That's very good. Ron,
this report said that his ability to Morse code was limited only to yes and no's. And it further stated that the staff, who didn't know Morse code at all, was trying to communicate with him in Morse code.
Okay.
And that it basically amounted to gibberish, that there was nothing there.
Recognize this animal?
Perfect, Ron.
Perfect.
Ron is a brain-damaged person.
Okay.
So he's got alertness problems.
What is that? What part of the body is that?
He's got severe paralysis. He's got concentration problems. And now he's being asked to spell everything that it is that he wants to say.
Do it in Morse code. Perfect.
Yes!
We contacted the amateur radio club and a blind radio operator, Dave Melanson, VE2 MPD. And Dave started coming on a regular basis to the hospital to see Ron, to serve as Ron's interpreter.
Whose dog was Pepper? Yours or mine?
Mine.
And
what kind of dog was he?
What breed of dog was Pepper? Yes,
a beagle.
Right.
Good run.
I started to investigate how Morse code was being interfaced with adaptive technology. I found out that they could put his Morse code through a computer. That computer could have a voice synthesizer. It could be used to open his doors and to turn on and off his lights. And it was going to be the key, I thought, to his whole future. On the basis of the videotape that we had sent to the rehab, and that tape was basically of Ron doing Morse code, they accepted him. And so you had the physician at the rehab center willing to invest all of these resources, allotting all these resources to Ron to investigate the potential of the Morse code. And you have another physician claiming that he's in a semi-coma. So it set up these opposite sort of views of the same person. And so I think one has to reasonably question, well, what is the true state of Ron, first of all, and second of all, what could possibly be behind stating that he's in a vegetative state? And I think what's behind it is that they needed to move that bed. They needed to clear that bed, rather, at all costs.
Can I ask you a question, Ron?
Yes?
Yep.
Ron, we've noticed that you're keeping your eyes closed a lot more. Are your eyes bothering you again?
Yes.
Ron was discharged from the hospital. We packed up. We went to the rehab center, only for Ron to fail the physical entrance because his eye was infected. And the admitting physician there said, I can't invest in computers and high tech. He needs to have his eyes open to look on the screen. So there's no point. Back to the hospital to have the eye resolved. The eye had been a situation that had dragged on for months and months. It was a kind nurse who warned me that if the eye was not moved upon really very, very quickly, that he was going to lose the cornea. I think the neglect of the eye was just because he was disabled, and is, I think, a direct result of the first concept of Ron as really being a glass that's half empty and not half full. What is the usefulness of treating the eye of a patient who's so badly disabled and whose ultimate fate is to land up in a chronic institution?
Are they sensitive to light?
Yes.
The vision of Ron's future at that point became this man so badly paralyzed, losing an eye, and being locked away in a chronic institution where his only means of communication, Morse code, is being viewed as gibberish with no possibility of ever being able to explore that potential. That's all we were asking for, was the chance. Finally, I said, I want another opinion. we brought him to another hospital with a top ophthalmologist who, coincidentally, it seemed that there were an awful lot of disabled people in his office. And he looked at Ron and within 2 minutes had a contact lens in his eye. The next day, the eye was resolved, and Ron stayed with a contact lens from there on. We spent the summer in trying to keep our spirits up. We brought Ron to our summer cottage and hoped that in the new session, the fall session of rehab, that he would get in. And 2 days after Labor Day, we received the word that we were to report immediately.
Rehab.
We were out. I told him a big part of this journey was now behind us. That he was going to be around people who were going to try to help him.
H-A-B. Rehab. Where's the rehab?
Here.
That's right, here.
The whole world changed. The whole picture changed. Their attitude at the rehab was, you have to look at the glass as being half full, not half empty, which was a complete inverse of what they were doing to us at the hospital. It was always a stress on his disability, and he can't go and forward, and he can't improve from this point. And at the rehab, it's always, well, you have to keep at it, you have to wait and see, and we're going to work with what it is we have.
Who's it? Yeah, right. I just passed you. Who's it?
Based on some studies that we both looked at together, his physician and I, decided that they would start him on a course of neurotransmitting drugs, and they did, and Ron talked.
Can you do it even bigger? A. Good. E.
E.
O.
O. Cat.
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 Oh, very good. How do you think your recovery is going?
Not bad.
Not bad.
It brought out Ron's thinking and his feelings and who he was. And I can say that that was the time when I got my brother back. That's when I knew I had him back.
Thank you, Kevin. Why are your eyes shut?
I don't know.
Can you open them?
Good.
Okay, yeah. Why, am I so ugly to look at?
No.
No? Do you find me ugly?
No.
No. Am I cute or average?
Average.
Oh. And what do you think you are, cute or average?
Cute.
7 pounds, folks. 7 pounds. Look at that.
They try to give you back as much of your dignity as you possibly can take back, and they're not adverse to trying.
And can you lift it over your head? 7 pounds, ladies and gentlemen. Excellent.
Very nice.
Take a bow.
Can disabled people have worthwhile lives, in your opinion? What do you think? Worthwhile, full lives. Can disabled people have full lives, Ron? What do you think? You think so? You think you could have a full life?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But what happened to your brain? How did it get injured?
It seized up.
It what?
It seized up.
It seized up. When a brain seizes up, what do we call that?
A vacant spot.
A what?
A vacant spot.
A what?
A vegetable.
A vegetable?
Yeah.
Are you a vegetable?
No.
No. Were you a vegetable?
No.
No.
The relationship was becoming more complex, and it was more difficult to get him to do the stuff I wanted him to do.
Should be quiet.
To you, I should do that to your mouth? Eh? To my mouth.
I was pretty much a rehab fascist. No, I felt we've only got 3 months in this place, and we've really got to take advantage.
I'm going to push you till you talk normally. And one day when you're going to talk normally, you're going to come to me and you're going to say, thank you, Bonnie, for pushing me. Because I would have sat there with my mouth shut for years hadn't you pushed me. Because sometimes, Ron, you're a bit on the lazy side. Excuse me, but this is true. What are you doing now? Are you listening to my lecture? What are you doing with the clay? Who's the slave driver? Who's the slave?
What time do you want me to come back tomorrow morning? What time tomorrow morning? I should come here at what time? Write it down. Come here at what time? 9:30. He's good, eh? He knows that's usually the time I come.
How's your emotional state these days?
I'm down.
Yeah. Are you depressed?
No.
Are you happy?
Yes.
Yes. If you could have one wish, what would it be?
Ron did 3 months in the rehab center, and after that, the ball now fell into our court.
Lean forward.
In December of 1995, we were not ready with a new situation, a new home to bring Ron home to. And they had no option but to send him back to the same hospital. And instead of battling the system, which we had done for so long, the enemy now sort of changes face and becomes the enemy within us.
I'm very tired. I've been at this for 2 years. Pedro's behind the camera giving me looks that I'm not supposed to say that. I'll say whatever I want. It's a free country. Wanna play? Roll trunk. Go. Push. Yeah. And back. Push me. Push. Harder.
We remained in that hospital from December of 1995 until August of 1996. It took us all that time to reorganize and readjust our life. And of all the time that we had now and all the struggle we had gone through, Ron pretty much kept a stiff upper lip and in many ways was our leader. But now he was truly losing confidence and faith. He believed that he would never leave the hospital.
We are not to be. That is the... Whether it is...
Blood of mine.
You suffer the slings and the arrows of outrageous fortune.
The slings and arrows of outrageous fortune.
To take arms against the sea of troubles. And by opposing.
And by opposing.
And then.
Go, 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 go.
Take him out.
Perfect.
Fantastic.
Congratulations, Ronnie.
And we're gonna bust you out of here. Ron, we're partners in this. You, me, and Pedro, okay? You gotta understand that all the time that we go home, we're looking at the newspaper, we're contacting agents to get a house to bring you home. We would never ever leave you in an institution. You know that, eh? You know that, eh? Yeah. So is there any use to get discouraged? Does it serve anything? No. And do we ever abandon you here for long periods of time? No, we're always around you. So let's stay partners together. Your responsibility there is going to be to stay as positive as you can, okay?
Our responsibility is to find the right house. You know why I know it? Because you're so much better. If you hadn't improved, I'd be so discouraged. Now, the thing that's holding us back is a small thing. It's finding the right house. Do you know what I mean? But if you hadn't gotten better, that'd be a big thing, a hard problem to solve. Finding a house, that's not such a complicated problem. Full houses. You know what I mean? Yeah. So that one we'll solve.
Very good. That's better, you know.
That day was August the 6th, 1996. 3 years after his hemorrhage, 3 years after the prognosis that he would not even survive the night, Ron and I passed through the hospital doors for the last time. For those who said that he will never make it, that he will never survive, that he won't be, whatever prediction it was out of the thousands of predictions that they made, I hope this is going to be a form of education.
Look, Ron, welcome home. You see
Bonnie made a sign. It says, welcome home.
It says, 1,000 days later, 1,000 predictions later. You've made it. Congratulations, Ron. I hope you're going to like it here. What do you think so far?
I hope that there will be more people who will take the chance, more physicians who will take the chance and err on the side of life and err on the side of potential for recovery, maybe. Although it appears by my telling of this story that I was very focused and determined and knew exactly what to do at the right time, because my own observations were being questioned by people in authority, serious people in authority, physicians, I had deep questioning about my own observations in it and whether I could be on the wrong side of this issue. And what I would say is that if I had it over to do again, I would not for one second ever doubt what I have observed. One should never, ever be coerced or accept to abdicate one's own intuition or one's own observation in favor of authority. He responded so well to being at home, to being in a normal setting. And it was such a relief to have him with us in that normal setting at home.
Smile. Now a big salute.
You can't just say someone's got 5 centimeters missing from their thalamic region and therefore they will never achieve anything. You simply can't say that. The brain has too many unknown factors to be able to say that.
Okay, is the heel done?
Yeah. So, this house here, give me its address again. Pretty Pacific Avenue in?
Sandow.
And who lives here?
I don't know.
You do so?
Ron was by no means untouched in cognitive terms. He had short-term memory problems. He had concentration problems.
What address is those
sound on?
Isn't that your parents' house?
I live in a house.
Yeah, but that was a long time ago. Yeah.
It couldn't have been good for him to have waited so long for a shunt. My belief is that they did do additional damage, but it's, I think, a very difficult thing to prove. one way or the other.
So he came, he spent the whole day. Remember, Ron, last week? He spent the whole day.
But he was doing so well, and so much of the old Ron was still there, that it just didn't matter anymore.
Whoa, you scared me. Okay.
And this is the part of recovery, I think, that's rarely seen by people, rarely seen by physicians, making decisions at the life and death stage. And that's what happens to people like Ron years later. What constitutes the quality of life?
Are you trying to tell us something? You're smiling a lot. What's that silly grin on your face?
I'm pretty sure that there wasn't any film made about Bobby Russell.
When did he die?
When did he die?
Where?
He died in his parents' house in Rosemount. Here, look.
I'd want to go up in heaven.
You'd like to go up in heaven? When?
When
you die. But not before.
Mm-hmm.
How long are you going to stick around for?
3 years.
How long? How many years? What? Ron? You with me?
So I immediately phoned 911. They told me what to do. It took about 40 minutes for the ambulance to arrive, but I knew that he was dead. They took Ron out on a stretcher, and that's the last time I ever saw him. Ron was a part of us, both of us, Pedro's best friend, my brother. And I think Ron was able to bring out that side of both of us that is generous and patient and noble. After the newspaper article about Ron and me and Pedro was published, other people got in touch with me, other people who circumstances are slightly different, you know,
Hi,
but
Manny.
That who are experiencing the same kind of thing with hospitals.
Okay. Hey, Mark.
Remember Mark? Mark, you remember Bonnie?
Boy, do you look good.
Boy, are you.
Mark Levine is 19 years old, and 2 years ago, he had a brain hemorrhage from an aneurysm. Mark is still in an acute care hospital.
So, Dad, why don't you show me what you do with this?
The second word that's written there on that sheet of paper, tell us what that says. If that second word says dog, close your eyes and keep them closed. Attaboy. You see? Second word down.
He and his family struggle and wait. They wait for the appropriate setting. They wait for the rehabilitation that could transform Mark's life. But most of all, I think Mark, like Ron before him, and like many brain-damaged people, wait for a change in attitude.
You gotta lift it up to my hand. Right up here.
And when I look into Mark's eyes, I see Ron looking back at me.